We see true repentance in the Bible. King David, he took full responsibility for his sin. He said, I have sinned. It was his own fault. It was his own choice. He committed adultery. He killed one of his own subjects. And he saw what his sin was doing to God. He said, against you and you only have I sinned. He saw what his sin did to God. And when a man truly repents of his sin, he sees the disgrace and the dishonor he's brought to God. He sees how God is worthy of all of his life. And he has robbed God of what he is worthy of. When a man truly and sincerely and honestly and humbly repents of his sin, he sees what he has done to God himself. We see even the Apostle Peter denied the Lord three times. And the Lord restored him. Says, Peter, do you love me? Three times. Peter denied him three times. Jesus asked him three times. Do you love me? Peter was restored back into a loving relationship with Christ. That is what repentance is. It is the beginning of a love relationship with God. Of a loving relationship with Jesus Christ. When he becomes our focus, he becomes our life. He's the center of all that we do. Or as one preacher said, he's not just one of many interests. He is the supreme interest of our life. So now we've covered the necessity for repentance. We've covered the nature of repentance. Now I'd like to get into the motive of repentance. Why should we repent of our sins? Should we repent of our sins simply to escape hell and gain heaven? If a man repents of selfishness with a selfish motive, is he really repenting of selfishness? You can't selfishly repent of selfishness. Why should we repent of our sins? So that we can have the blessings of God? Because of what sin is. We should repent of our sins for the same reason God outlawed sin. Why did God outlaw sin? Because he sees the destruction it brings to his universe. He sees the chaos and the disorder out of adultery and fornication and stealing and theft and lying and adultery. He sees the destruction of it. God outlawed sin because of what sin is. And that's why you ought to repent of your sins. Because of what sin is. I remember being at the age of 15 locked up in a jail cell and facing many years in jail that the Lord delivered me from. But before, and I was praying unto God, God save me from this. This is more than I can bear. This is too much for me. But my focus would change. The Holy Spirit working on me, convicting me, changed my focus. And I said, God, change my heart. I can't live this way anymore. I just can't live this way anymore. In sin. In disobedience. Seeing what it's doing to my family. Seeing what it's doing to my neighbors. Seeing what it's doing to my community. Seeing what it's doing. I just can't live this way anymore. And I said, God, even if I have to go to jail for the rest of my life, I cannot live this way anymore. So my motive was to forsake sin because of what sin is. People need to realize their sin hurts their neighbor, that their sin dishonors God. That sin robs God of what he deserves. That sin robs God of the service that he's worthy of. And that sin is breaking the very heart of God. I remember going to a fishing event. And there were about thousands of people. And I'm not going to name any names, I'm not going to name who was preaching or anything, but there was a preacher there. And he gave this message, and we'll talk about a powerful speaker. He had some oratory abilities, and he could get the crowd on the edge of their seat and was emotionally charging and gripping their attention, and he preached his heart out. But his whole message, he just preached about how if you have the presence of God in your life, you'll be blessed. If you have the presence of God in your life, your family will be blessed. If you have the presence of God in your life, even your dog will be blessed, he said. And that was his message. Just, if you have God, you'll be blessed. And after preaching and getting everyone emotionally gripped and just like putty in his hands, and then he gave an altar call. And he said, well, how many of you want to be blessed? How many of you want the presence of God in your life? Just come to the altar. He said, come to the altar. If you want your neighbors to be blessed, come to the altar. If you want your family to be blessed, come. He said, even if you want your dog to be blessed, come to the altar. He said, who would turn down such an invitation like that? So sure enough, he had everyone at the altar. Sinner or saint, didn't matter. Who didn't want more of a blessing? But then he led the crowd in the sinner's prayer. And I thought, what is this? This is a salvation altar call? This man didn't once mention sin. This man didn't once mention hell. Not even once did he mention the cross of Jesus Christ. How can you give an altar call without mentioning Jesus Christ? What are these people coming to the altar for? It's not for salvation. It was a bait and switch, is what it was. They came for one thing, he offered them another. And they all bowed their heads and they said the sinner's prayer. And they never heard the gospel. So the motive needs to be right in repentance. And if the motive is not right in repentance, there's no real repentance. And if there is no real repentance, there is no real salvation. We don't come to God because of what we can get. We come to God because of what we can give. Because he's worthy of all of us. He made us. He's our neighbor. And he wants nothing but good for his universe. I'd like to simply end with just two simple very points about repentance. We must turn from all known sin in our life. Don't excuse it. Don't justify it. Don't coddle it. Don't comfort it. Cut it off. Jesus said, if your hand causes you to sin, cut it off. If your eye causes you to sin, pluck it out. It's better for you to go through life and go into hell without these or go through life without these and then go to hell with both. Right. So Jesus was saying, you need to cut off the sin in your life if you don't want to go to hell. We must turn from all known sin in our life. God doesn't want us to sin. God gives us the ability not to. And we must call the world to repent of their sins. Not just to care about ourselves and care about our own eternities and care about our own salvation or care about our own families. God has a global picture. God has a heart for all mankind. We must call the whole world to repentance. To turn from their sin. Because without the repentance of sin, there is no forgiveness of sin. Christ died and his blood has been spilt. But God will not turn from his wrath unless sinners turn from their sin. The blood of Jesus Christ covers those that are converted.